We're in northern Minnesota on Lake Capitogama, and it's well, it's almost, I guess you could call it fall now, but beautiful thing about this time of the year is just a classic lake, classic wall lake with a lot of classic structure. And the dip finder doesn't lie, and so it's just high efficiency fishing. Drive around until you see fish, mark fish. When you mark fish, throw the marker buoy out and fish them, but you don't put a line in the water unless there's fish below you, and it's just a jig fisherman's dream on really one of the most beautiful lakes that I've ever seen.
Yeah, this time of year, Jason, you can find these fish up on top of these humps, sometimes as shallow as 15, 16 feet of water. And like we just seen a few minutes ago, we can get them down into 30 feet. Now there's some fish right there, it looks like, on the graph in that 20 foot range. But this time of year, they're covering the structure. They're either up feeding and getting their bellies full for the winter, or else they're down off these humps a little bit. And today we can see them up on top as well. Here's one, Jason.
Yeah,
there you go.
Right where he should be. We were marking fish right in that zone.
Yeah, he's straight down there and he's...
Oh yeah.
Looks like a nice eater fish.
That would be a good eater. You guys do a lot of shore lunches and stuff too, don't you?
Do a lot of shore lunches, yeah. The customers kind of like it. We have this over 200 to 300 islands in the park area with a lot of campsites and shore lunch areas. And that's pretty typical of what our eaters are like.
You know, a place this beautiful, you almost have to do a shore lunch, you know
what?
I mean, it's just part of being out here. I mean, just a gorgeous, gorgeous lake.
Yeah, you get out there and you can have a nice picnic lunch and pick blueberries and just spend an afternoon on an island.
That's good
makes
living.
Makes for a good day.
Good living.
Let's get another one.
There's one.
Got him?
Yep.
All right.
Right down, straight down there in about that 30 foot of water there.
Yeah, this is just classic structure fishing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Fun way to catch fish. Fish might be a little bigger than you think, huh?
He's about that fry pan size, I think. Maybe a little bigger.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he's a little bigger, isn't he?
Oh, yeah. Golden walleyes, huh?
Yeah.
There. Nice. You know, I've often thought as beautiful as this area is, this is probably the closest thing that you can get to a Canadian Shield type fly-in fishing experience without having to fly.
I know, isn't that nice?
Isn't that just a gorgeous,
beautiful, healthy walleyes.
Yeah, I mean, that's the same walleye you catch up in northern Manitoba or northern Ontario.
If you really like to jig fish, you can't find a better area to do it. There are so many islands, so much structure off each of these islands, and every one of these points are holding fish, walleyes, just like that right there. Sometimes they're on top of these humps and points, and sometimes they're down there a little deeper like they seem to be this morning. But it's a jig fisherman's dream, it really is.
Yeah, well, I'll never get tired of catching fish on that jig. If that's one walleye, one more walleye in my life, give me a jig.
Give me a jig, that's the way to go. It never seems to fail.
That's true.
Let's get another one.
Here's a good fish. Yeah, that's about as good as it gets, huh? 6 pound monofilament and 25 feet right straight down. Yeah, the fish is right where it's supposed to be.
Yeah. Another nice little eater, huh? Yeah.
Good fish.
All right. Real. Boy, these fish are just got that golden color on them. Just gorgeous.
Look how heavy they are.
Yeah, just gorgeous fish.
They are solid. Man. They are solid.
That was just on a small fathead. I don't know, we've been trying to experiment with different minnows. I think you caught the first fish on a shiner.
Yeah.
Used a rainbow to catch one, missed a few fish on bigger minnows, but doesn't really seem to be any rhyme or reason to it right now.
No, I think they're feeding all of it. That's a nice fish right there, nice fish.
There. You know, the whole key in my mind, you know, fishing this type of structure is, you know, a lot of times you have these classic boulders, these big rocks, and, you know, if people talk about boat control and marking fish and then fishing above those fish, but, you know, I think what often doesn't get said is the fact that just keeping that line straight up and down. A lot of times if you're in any type of an angle in these types of rocks with a jig, you're going to be hung up. And so half the fight is keeping the boat above the fish and keeping the boat on the spot, but the other half is chasing the line, chasing after that jig to just keep that line as vertical as possible, straight up and down. You're going to catch a lot more fish on this type of structure.
The important thing about that, Jason, is when you're vertical, you're fishing straight up and down, you feel that fish a lot better. your rod's doing its job. You have this, these nice particular rods that you have in there, and they are more sensitive when you're straight up and down. And the nice thing about it is that when you have a hook set, you're coming straight up with that jig, and you're hooking that fish much better. So it's a better hook set too. Staying vertical is the key. There's one. There's a fish.
All right.
I'm going over.
Another fish below us. Whoa.
What, do we got a bass?
Yeah, nice bass.
Big bass, huh? I think that's what we're seeing on top of these humps right this time of year. These big smallmouth come up here and start feeding. Yeah, nice smallmouth.
Oh yeah, look at that. That's a dandy.
Bronze back.
Big ol' brown bass on the top and walleyes on the sides.
Look how fat this fish is.
Look at that fish. That fish is thick. Come on, get it in the net. There. Wow. That is fun.
That's not much funner than catching a good bronze back on top of one of these humps, I'll tell you. Oh. This fall of the year, they've got their feed bag on, don't they?
Isn't that cool? Yeah, that's the neat thing about, that's what I love about this area too, is you know, you catch big smallmouth and nice walleyes on the same spot. Those fish will be on different parts of the spot, but nonetheless, you don't have to go far. Beautiful fish.
Yeah, very nice.
Fun, that looked fun.
A lot of fun, yeah, those are, they give you the fight. Pound for pound, they're one of the best fighting fish there is.
I always joke, you know, walleyes make the phone ring, and obviously they're important in this part of the world, but one of my favorite fish are
smallmouth bass.
Smallmouth, just like what you just caught.
Yeah, they're a lot of fun. And we got a lot of big ones like that right on top of these humps this time of year. You can really cash in on them.
That's for sure.
That's cool.
You know, the uniqueness of this particular lake is it was a Canadian Shield Lake and is nestled in Voyageurs National Park. It consists of around 26,000 acres of water, miles and miles of shoreline. The wilderness of this lake is what attracts so many people from all over the country to come and visit. When you leave the shores of the resorts and the cabins, you're in true wilderness for miles and miles and miles. It's connected to Namekan Lake, which is also a huge lake, which borders Canada. But all of Cabotogama is in the U.S.
Can't wait to see what this is.
It's not wanting to come up, that's for sure.
No. Looks fun.
Yeah, acts like a big walleye.
Oh yeah.
There she is.
Yeah, nice walleye. There we go. Nice. Nice.
Big fat walleye.
Your middle's mangled up there.
Sitting down there in that 30 plus foot of water.
Yeah, boy, that's a
nice jig right there.
Nice fish, huh?
Little girth on them fish.
Oh yeah, these fish are just thick, solid
nice
fish.
Fat fish, nice solid fish.
Do you find these fish on this deep structure most of the year then?
Yeah, you can, usually after mid-June, these fish will come from the shorelines out into the reefs, and a lot of times they'll hang on the bottom of those humps and those reefs, like we're on this point right here.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll feed there all summer long. And in the evening, sometimes they'll come up to the top of those reefs, or a windy day, kind of like what we have today. A lot of times they'll come up on top of them shells and start feeding. But most of the time, you'll find them right on the break, right on the bottom of those points and those humps, right on the bottom in the 30, 31 foot of range, like we're fishing today.
Yeah, you know, the beauty of it, you know, with map ships and good sonar, you know, you can drive to each spot.
Yeah.
You know, just go on a milk run from spot to spot. And that's what we've been doing today. We've been just jumping from spot to spot, just hitting little humps. And if it's a clean bottom, we just keep driving. And if there's clutter on the bottom and marks on the bottom, throw out a marker buoy and fish it. So.
Yeah, exactly.
Pretty simple program that anybody can do with it. And anybody can come out here and catch fish. So. Here's a fish. You know, it's funny, Tim, you know, before we had GPSs and all this equipment, marker buoy is pretty important to a walleye fisherman, and a lot of people have gotten away from it with the GPSs and the map chips, but tell you what, for this type of fishing, it still helps, doesn't it?
It really does. A big body of water, kind of keep you right on them.
Oh yeah,
and
look at
tell
there,
you what.
Look at there, nice walleye.
Nice,
nice. There we go. Just a nice reference point to look at. There.
Yeah, you can always come back to your random spot and these walleyes, they'll school together and they'll stay in that general location, so that buoy kind of helps you keep right on them.
Get a hold of them here. My fingers are a little...
Fingers a little cold?
A little numb. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
nice,
just a
fat.
Just a gorgeous, gorgeous walleye.
That's good fat fish.
There he is.
There you go.
There. How's that?
How's that feel?
Best feeling in the world. Crossing that fish's eyes. Oh yeah, fish is staying down nice.
Nice fish, Jason?
Yeah. You know, this is a classic deal tour. You got a nice big rock hump behind us. It's in about 20 feet of water. We're fishing a little finger that's coming off in about 27 feet, and they're right on the edge. You know, the beauty is, you know, we're marking the fish here, and so you mark them, and that gives you the confidence to stick around. Oh yeah, there's a nice walleye there, Tim.
Yeah, nice big walleye.
There we go. Keeping it simple. They just have that gorgeous gold hue. Look at that.
Yeah.
There. Well, yeah, just the gorgeous, gorgeous color. Put my finger in there. There. Boy, look at that. I can't even see that jig. Oh, that jig just popped right out. Isn't that a gorgeous fish? Look at that. I don't know if you can see that on the camera, but...
Got a blue tint right to its fin.
Yeah,
blue,
yeah. Isn't that a pretty beautiful fish?
Yeah.
Very cool. Yeah, that's
gorgeous
fun.
Walleye. Nice job.
Nice. All right.
You know, a common problem for jig fishermen is they tend to get the line wrapped around the tip of their rod. I'm using 6-pound monofilament line here, and monofilament has a tendency to have memory, and so the more you jig, the more it will get around to twisting around and get around the tip of your line. So what I've done and what we do is take a barrel swivel. This is a number 10 barrel swivel, and go up about 12 inches to 18 inches above your jig. And you put that barrel swivel on there, and that takes out that twist, and your line will last a lot longer, and the price of line is important to keep that line straight. So put a barrel swivel on there 12 to 18 inches above your jig, and you'll get that twist, it'll stay out of the line, and you won't have that problem around the tip of your rod anymore.
You know, when we're going over these humps, you crawl along real slow. You know, obviously if you're crawling along, you can't be fishing vertical, and so you'll see your jig go at an angle behind the boat, underneath the boat. And typically what we'll do is we'll just scoot along, and electronics are so important with this deep water, where when we're marking fish, and then what we'll do is we'll slow down and try to get that line as vertical as we can. And so you're pushing along until you mark a fish, get vertical again, and that seems to be the key to getting bit. But the thing to stress is that a lot of times in these rocks and boulders, there's a lot of nooks and crannies for these fish to hide. And so probably the biggest thing is don't always look for too much. You know, a lot of times people will drive around, you know, trying to look for a spot that just got all kinds of perfect arcs like you see in demo mode on a depth finder. And reality is if you come up a corner, up a side, where you know, you just get a couple of marks separated from the bottom, chances are if there's a few fish or higher than those boulders that show up on your screen, there's a lot more of them tucked in those nooks and crannies where you can't see them. And so that's just a general rule of thumb, is don't look for too much when you're fishing rocks. There's just a few that show up. There's usually a lot more hiding in those blind spots.
Here's one right here.
You can't see.
Got him. This is a good one.
Oh, there you go. There you go. Dandy fish.
This is a good one. Jason, this one's got some pull.
Yeah, that's a good fish.
This one looks like he might be a little thicker between the shoulders right here.
Yep.
This nice. Doesn't get old right here. Sitting right on the bottom of that hump, aren't they?
Yeah, right on the back side of that dip. You know, it's funny, sometimes you go up a certain angle and you don't mark many fish, you turn around, you go up the other way, and they show up.
There she is right there, yeah.
Hitting that right angle. Oh yeah, look at there. Oh yeah, there. Boy, these fish are gorgeous.
Nice.
Some of the coloration on these fish is just beautiful. Look at that. I see that.
Yeah, beautiful gold.
Green. Oh, yeah.
Look how thick these fish are.
They are. a lot of young of the year perch and shiners out here that these fish are eating?
Yeah, yeah, they're down there feeding on in the 4, 5, 6 inch perch minnows and of course walleye fry and stuff.
So. You find that the bigger minnows work best in the fall, or is it hard to say?
Yeah, they do. I like to go for the bigger with the bigger minnows. You know, I'm using some we're using some chubs that are a good sized chubs right now, and so
get that water. Nice work.
From our base camp in Devil's Lake, North Dakota, we travel the whole Midwest looking for the best fishing bites. If you like real-time fish reports, find out what bodies of water that we're fishing just to find the general patterns and techniques that we're using, give us a like on Facebook at Hit the Road with Jason Mitchell Outdoors.
You know, all the spots that we've caught fish today are just deep classic structures, sunken islands, deep points, and specifically, the tops of all these spots have big rocks on them. You'll see those rocks right on your depth finder, you know, just big rocks. Some of the rocks are enormous. But that being said, one thing that I've had to learn the hard way a few times over the years is sometimes, you know, with jigging, people make this overall assumption, use the smallest, lightest jig that you can. But sometimes in the fall, and sometimes when you're fishing this deep structure, especially if you're battling wind, is maybe another rule of thumb is to use the heaviest jig that you can. Use a heavy enough jig, a big enough jig, where you keep that jig straight up and down. Because if you're at an angle or if you start to drag that jig, you're gonna get hung up almost immediately. Besides using a jig and keeping it straight up and down, another trick that Tim uses a lot, which is pretty common up here in northern Minnesota, where you have a lot of these rocks, is use a round egg sinker with a short snell, and then again, fish that live bait rig just like a jig, straight up and down, right over the side of the boat. And that round egg sinker will go through those boulders a lot easier. And so snags are a part of fishing, but if you fish, you know, straight up and down and keep your presentation vertical, it gets a lot easier to catch these fish.
Cabotogama runs on an average of around 35 feet. It has holes as deep as 80 feet of water. But the variety of fish species that it offers is truly amazing. It has northern pike, smallmouth bass, large crappies, jumbo perch. The one big calling card that they have, of course, is the walleye. When coming to visit Cabotogama Lake, we have a variety of resorts that you can stay at that will cater to many different families or fishing groups, corporate groups such as that. If you're interested in what the fishing report is, you can look us up on our website at cabotogama.com.
Oh, there you. All right. All right, Tim.
Another good fish right here, Jason.
Oh, yeah. Well, be a nice way to end the day. We've had a great day, you know what?
Yeah, I know, a lot of nice fish.
Yeah, these are quality fish.
This one might be as good as any of them right here.
Yeah, I think so.
Boy, you can just feel it pull.
You know when you got to hold the rod with two hands?
Yeah, when you got to do that. I'd rather do this than go to a gym and work out with weights, I tell you that.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm with you there. I just can't wait to see it.
You know, yeah, there she is right there.
Nice fish, Tim.
Yeah, thanks. All right. Nice fish.
Wow, here, I'll get out of the net here for you. Here. Yeah. I just love the... You know, there's a lot to like about this place. I mean, this gorgeous walleye just like that. Beautiful scenery. I mean, we haven't seen more than a couple boats all day. I mean, it's just a pretty special place.
It really is. It's a gift right here. This is a land, a water that's all these islands that are around here. There's so much structure to fish, so many places to go. If you don't like one spot or not having luck in one spot, there's another little hump or little reef to go to, a little island to go to. And the nice thing is you're not bumping boats with everybody. You got the lake to yourself a lot of times. So
yeah.
It's a real treasure.
A structure fisherman's dream, a walleye fisherman's dream, and a jig fisherman's dream, I'll tell you that. Thanks so much for being on the show.
Thank you.
Jason Mitchell Outdoors has been brought to you by Shields, North Dakota Tourism, Yarcraft Boats, Yamaha, Onyx, Sonar Phone, Salmo, Northland Fishing Tackle, and Jason Mitchell Elite Series Rods.
To find out more information on Jason Mitchell Outdoors, make their official webpage one of your favorite pages. Find out upcoming show schedules and airtimes, along with past shows, article and product reviews at jasonmitchelloutdoors.com. Great information on the outdoors is just one click away.